Hare Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Nasta praeshu papadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya
Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhagavati Uttama Shloke
Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki
Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki.
So I'm going to read a verse from the prayers by Queen Kunti. Queen Kunti is offered in the Srimad Bhagavatam in the first canto, chapter 8. There's a number of prayers. Maybe you know some of these prayers by Queen Kunti, you know?
Yeah.
The ladies who are reading, studying. There are some beautiful prayers. So I've been going through the prayers one by one. Tonight we're going to read text number, I think it's 34. Is it
34? 1834.
1834. This one? Bhāravatāra. Nāyānyē. Okay, we'll chant it. I'll read it first and you can repeat. Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhuvo nava evo dhatto.
Bhuvo nava evo dhatto.
Nava evo dhatto.
Nava evo dhatto.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Jato yatma bhuvanatita.
Jato yatma bhuvanatita.
Jato yatma pavartita.
Jato yatma bhuvanatita.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhuvo nava evo dhatto.
Bhuvo nava evo dhatto.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Jato yatma bhavartita.
Jato yatma bhavartita.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Nava evo dhatto.
Nava evo dhatto.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Siddhantya buri parena.
Jato yatma bhuvartita.
Jato yatma bhuvartita.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē.
Bhāravatāra Nāyānyē. Bhuvo nava evo dhatto.
Siddhantya buri bhārena.
Siddhantya buri bhārena.
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
भारावतारणान्ये
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
भारावतारणान्ये
भारावतारणान्ये
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः भारावतारणान्ये
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः भारावतारणान्ये
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
जातो हि आत्मा
भुवार्थितः
Anybody else like to chant?
Bhara avatar anyanye.
Bhara avatar anyanye.
Bhuvo nava ivo dado.
Bhuvo nava ivo dado.
Siddhantya puri bharena.
Siddhantya puri bharena.
Jato hi atma bhu arthita.
Jato hi atma bhu arthita. भारावतारणान्ये
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
जातो हि आत्मा
भुवार्थितः
भारावतारणान्येन
भारावतारणान्येन
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
भुवो नाव इवो ददौ
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण
सीदन्त्या भूरि भारेण जातो हि आत्मा भुवार्थितः
Very good. I'll read the word meaning. Bhara avataranaya.
Bhara avataranaya.
Just to reduce the burden to the world.
Just to reduce the burden to the world.
Anye.
Anye.
Others.
Others.
Bhuva.
Bhuva.
Of the world.
Of the world.
Nava.
Nava.
Boat.
Boat.
Iva.
Iva.
Light.
Light.
Udadao.
Udadao.
on the sea.
On the sea.
Siddhantya.
Siddhantya.
Aggrieved.
Aggrieved.
Bhuri.
Bhuri.
Extremely.
Extremely.
Bharena.
Bharena.
The burden. Oh, by the burden.
By the burden.
Jata.
Jata.
You were born.
You were born.
He.
He.
Certainly.
Certainly.
Atma Bhuva.
Atma Bhuva.
By Brahma.
By Brahma.
Artita.
Artita.
Being prayed for.
Being prayed for.
Translation. Others say that the world being overburdened like a boat, like a boat at sea, is much aggrieved, and that Brahma, who is your son, prayed to you, and so you appeared to diminish the trouble. You can repeat. Others say,
that the world being overburdened
like a boat at sea,
is much aggrieved,
and that Brahma,
who is your son,
prayed for you,
and so you have appeared.
To diminish the trouble. And then purport by Srila
Prabhupada.
Brahma is the first living being born just after the creation. Is a direct son of Narayan. Narayan. Narayan, as Garbhodakshay Vishnu, first of all entered the material universe. Without spiritual contact, matter cannot create. This principle was followed from the very beginning of the creation. The Supreme Spirit entered the universe, and the first living being, Brahma, was born on a lotus flower grown out of the transcendental abdomen of Vishnu. Vishnu is therefore known as Padmanabha. Brahma is known as Atmabhu, because he was begotten directly from the Father without any contact of Mother Lakshmiji. Lakshmiji was present near Narayan, engaged in the service of the Lord. And still, without contact with Lakshmiji, Narayan begot Brahma. That is the omnipotency of the Lord. One who foolishly considers Narayan like other living beings should take a lesson from this. Narayan is not an ordinary living being. He is the personality of Godhead himself, and he has all the potencies of all the senses in all parts of his transcendental body. An ordinary living being an ordinary living being begets a child by sexual intercourse, and he has no other means to beget a child other than the one designed for him. But Narayan, being omnipotent, is not bound to any condition of energy. He is complete and independent to do anything and everything by his various potencies. Very easily and perfectly, Brahma is therefore directly the son of the Lord, and was not put into the womb of a mother. Therefore, he is known as Atmabhu. This Brahma is in charge of further creations in the universe, secondarily reflected by the potency of the omnipotent. Within the halo of the universe, there is a transcendental planet known as Swetadweep, which is the abode of the Shirodakshayi Vishnu, the Paramatma feature of the Supreme Lord. Whenever there is trouble in the universe that cannot be solved by the administrative demigods, they approach Brahmaji for a solution. And if it is not to be solved even by Brahmaji, then Brahmaji consults and prays to the Shirodakshayi Vishnu for an incarnation and solution to the problems. Such a problem arose when Kamsa and others were ruling over the earth, and the earth became too much overwhelmed by the misdeeds of the Asuras. Brahmaji, along with other demigods, prayed at the shore of the Shirodak ocean, and they were advised of the descent of Krishna as the son of Vasudev and Devaki. So some people say that the Lord appeared because of the prayers of Brahmaji. Om Ajnana Timarandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Tasur Militanyena Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama Shri Chaitanya Manovisham Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayamurvatamayam Tadapi Svatantikam Vandeham Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagratatam Sahagana Raghunathan Vitam Samsajevam Sarvaitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanam Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jayapati Gopesha Gopita Kanta Nana Kanta Namostate Tapatanchana Gaurangi Nare Vrindavaneshwari Vishwanu Sri Devi Namami Hari Priye Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Pristaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavani Paschatya Mishavarine Pancha Kaupata Rubhyasya Kripa Sindhu Vayeva Cha Patitanam Bhavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasati Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare So Queen Kunti is offering her prayers to Lord Krishna. And she's been describing different reasons why Lord Krishna has appeared in the world. And she's describing actually Krishna is called Aja, meaning one who is unborn. He never takes birth because he's the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He's the original cause of the creation. He's God of everyone, the Supreme Godhead. So he doesn't take birth, but at the same time, he sometimes does come to the world and it appears like he's taking birth. So Queen Kunti is giving some different reasons why Krishna did like that. And in the previous verse, she mentioned that Krishna came because Vasudeva and Devaki, in their previous life, they had performed tapasya to get the Lord as their child. They did great tapasya, and they wanted to have the Lord as their child, not once, but three times. And so it happened, the Lord came as the child of Vasudeva. For, well, in their previous lives, Vasudeva and Devaki, they were known as Prishni and Sutapa. And that was when they did their tapasya, and the Lord came as their child for the first time. And then the second time, then Prishni and Sutapa, they became Kashyapa and Aditi. And then the Lord came as their child for the second time. And then Kashyapa and Aditi, they became Vasudeva and Devaki. And Lord Krishna came as their child. So that was one reason why Krishna came as their child. And here, another reason is being given by Queen Kunti. She is saying because Lord Brahma had prayed to the Lord to come. It happened that before the appearance of Lord Krishna, the world was overburdened by many of the demoniac Kshatriya kings. You know, in the Vedic culture, the society was divided into different varnas: Brahmin, Kshatri, Vaishya, and Sudra. So in the times 5,000 years ago, before the Kali Yuga, the world was overburdened. There were many Kshatriyas, many kings, you will know, coming from India. In India in the past, there were many small kingdoms, little kingdoms, and there were kings in each of the different kingdoms. Like Jaipur, of course, that was a kingdom. He had the king there, the Maharaja, and many different villages and districts were ruled. In the time of Lord Chaitanya, there was Maharaj Prataparudra, and he was ruling what was called Utkal. You know Utkal? Orissa, or initially, previously it was called Utkal, and the empire, the kingdom of Maharaj Prataparudra, he was the king of Puri. His main headquarters was in Puri, but he had a kingdom going all the way down to Chennai, all the way down. So big kingdom, powerful king. And on the other side, you had Bengal, you had the Nawab Hussein Shah was ruling, and he was very powerful. He had the kingdom ruling a lot of Bengal and attacking other different places. So there were many different kings. So it happened, the earth was overburdened by all of these different kings. And Mother Bhumi, she is the deity of the earth. She was in great anxiety because the kings were not pious. They were not very pious. And because they were not very pious, it gave a lot of trouble to the earth planet. So Mother Bhumi was in a very bad condition. She felt very disturbed. So she went to Lord Brahma to appeal for help. And she went there, and all the different demigods came, Lord Shiva and other different demigods, they all assembled there. And Bhumi was explaining her plight, her distress, and she was asking Lord Brahma for help. So Lord Brahma, even Lord Brahma, although he's, you know, the senior most person in the universe, he's the original person born first, he's Atma Bhu, we were reading here, he's born from the lotus flower. In our universe we have Chaturmukh Brahma. Right? We are a small universe, so Lord Brahma only has four heads. But in other universes, they're much bigger, and Brahma will have many heads. So there are many Brahmas, and each universe has got a Brahma, and there's countless universes coming. At the time of creation, the universes all come out from the body of Mahavishnu, or Karanadakashayi Vishnu, they're the he's the first the first Purusha avatar, and the creation comes about from him. He's laying on the causal ocean, and the universe has come out from his body. And then he expands himself into each universe, and he expands into each universe as Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. And Garbhodakshayi Vishnu then creates an ocean in the bottom of the universe. It's like a big egg, and Vishnu enters into that cosmic egg, and from his body perspiration comes, and it makes an ocean in the bottom of the universe. And he lays down on that ocean, and from his navel the lotus flower comes. A transcendental lotus flower grows, and Lord Brahma then appears from that lotus flower. So Lord Brahma is just, he didn't take birth in the womb of a mother, he just came from the lotus flower. So he's called Atma Bhut. He's the self-born. So when there's trouble in the universe, Bhumi and the different demigods would approach Lord Brahma for help. So on this particular occasion, Lord Brahma didn't know what to do. It was such a big problem. So he prayed to Lord Vishnu. I told you about two Vishnus, right? There was Karanodakshayi Vishnu, or something we just say Mahavishnu. And then the second one was Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. And there's a third Vishnu, Shirodakshayi Vishnu. And Shirodakshayi Vishnu is the super soul, the Paramatma in the heart of all living entities. Right? In our heart, we have two souls. There's the Div Atma and the Param Atma. So the Param Atma is Shirodakshayi Vishnu. And Shirodakshayi Vishnu has his own planet in the universe. And it's a spiritual planet. Although it's in the material universe, it's never destroyed at the time of the annihilation. So Lord Vishnu resides there on this Sweta Dweep, and it's surrounded by the milk ocean. And Lord Brahma, he prays to Lord Vishnu, Shirodakshayi Vishnu, who prays to Lord Vishnu for help. What should be done? What to do? So he cannot go there, but he can pray. Just like, you know, we talk to people on the mobile phone, you call them up. So in the past, 5,000 years ago, they didn't need telecommunication. They did it by mental powers, by, how would you say,
telepathy,
yeah. Communicate through the mind, from the mind. Brahma meditated on Lord Vishnu in Sweta Dweep. And he meditated to Lord Vishnu, told him the situation, that Mother Bhumi is greatly disturbed and none of the demigods know what to do. So what should be done? And at that time, Lord Vishnu then communicated by telepathy, by meditation. He told Lord Brahma that tell everyone that I am going to come and I'm going to take my birth in the Yadu dynasty, and they should also appear, and they can also come and take part in the pastimes. So this was one way in which, one reason in which Lord Krishna came to this world. The mission of Lord Krishna is described in the Bhagavad Gita, that Lord Krishna says, Paritranaya Sadhuna, Lord Krishna is describing his mission, why he comes to this world, to re-establish Dharma. He wants to establish the religious principles. And one way in which he did that was by speaking the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita, the song of God. It's an important teaching for us. Another reason why the Lord comes is to remove the burden, the demonic, the asuras who are giving so much trouble and disturbing the situation on the planet. So Lord Krishna could say that He came for that reason, to kill the different demons, the demonic Kshatriya kings. And Lord Krishna did that, but one way in which He did that was arranging the battle of Kurukshetra. He brought all the different kings together at the battle of Kurukshetra, and they fought together. They all killed each other. They all annihilated each other. So many deaths were there at the battle of Kurukshetra. So this was Lord Krishna's arrangement. He wanted these demonic kings to be removed because they were burdening the earth and they were disturbing the situation on the planet. When the people, when the kings are pious and good, then it's very nice for the planet, and the people will be happy and they will flourish and enjoy prosperity, material and spiritual prosperity. But when the kings are of a bad nature, when they are demoniac, then they greatly trouble the people and everybody lives a miserable life and they're unhappy. So Lord Krishna wanted to establish the Pandavas. He wanted that the Pandavas should rule because He knew them to be devotees, and He knew that if they will rule the world, then the people will be very happy and prosperous. They will enjoy an auspicious condition of life. So Lord Krishna brought all the kings together and they fought the great battle of Kurukshetra, described in Mahabharata, which is the history of Bharatvarsha. So Lord Krishna came to remove the burden of the world, and He also came to give pleasure to His devotees. And that's the most important reason for Krishna coming. He doesn't need to come here to kill the demons. He can remove the demons very easily by His own power, because He's present in the heart of everyone. So He can remove them. He can just simply give them some, He can just simply leave the heart. When they leave the heart, then the person dies, right? The difference between the living body and the dead body, there is no soul in the dead body. When the soul leaves the body, then it's the dead body. So Krishna can simply arrange for the soul to leave the body. People will all die. But Lord Krishna arranged battle of Kurukshetra, and it happened that all these different kings, they got liberation. How? Because Lord Krishna was present on the battlefield. And because Lord Krishna was present on the battlefield, that all of the kings, that when they died, they were in the presence of Lord Krishna. And so they were freed of all of their sins, and they were all able to be liberated. So it was the mercy of Lord Krishna to bring all these kings together and to liberate them to the higher destination, that they could go into the spiritual realm. So everything Lord Krishna does is for the good of people. We shouldn't find any fault in any of the activities of Lord Krishna. So Lord Krishna comes into this world, He also comes to give pleasure to His devotees. That's the most important reason for Krishna coming to this world, that His devotees, they're already liberated souls, right? because you're chanting the Maha Mantra and because you're worshipping Krishna and reading the books, so you're already liberated. We don't have to worry about, but the devotees are very anxious to have association with Lord Krishna. They want to be with Krishna, to enjoy his, to give direct service to Krishna. It's nice to serve the deity of Krishna, and it's nice to chant the name of Krishna, but it's also nice to be personally with Krishna and to be able to serve him. So Lord Krishna also likes to be with his devotees. He enjoys to come and be with his devotees. The devotees get pleasure from Krishna. Krishna gets pleasure from his devotees. It's a reciprocation. Lord Krishna enjoys being with his devotees. And he had arranged that they would all come, different devotees. Some were demigods. Demigods are not such pure devotees. Demigods, they have material desires. But other devotees came. Some came from the spiritual world. They came to be with Krishna, to take part in his pastimes. Devotees like Nanda and Yashoda, Nanda Maharaja and Yashoda Mata, they are always Krishna's mother and father. Now Vasudeva and Devaki, they were able to get the pleasure of having Krishna appear as their child, but they could not enjoy the childhood Leela. They could not enjoy all the pastimes of Lord Krishna. Devaki had one brother, Kamsa, and Kamsa had put Vasudeva and Devaki into prison. And whenever Devaki would give birth to a child, Kamsa would kill the child. But somehow when Devaki gave birth to the eighth child, Vasudeva was able to take that child to the home of Nanda and Yashoda. He was able to get out of the jail in the middle of the night and to cross the Yamuna and go to Nanda Maharaj's home. And at that time, Yashoda Mata had delivered also child. So Vasudeva exchanged the children. He took the baby girl which Yashoda had delivered, and he put the boy which Devaki had delivered with Mother Yashoda. So that next morning, Kamsa came. He wanted to kill. Where's the child? He'd already killed six of the children of Devaki. He wanted, but the one he was worried most about was the eighth child. Because at the time of Devaki's marriage, the omen was the eighth child of your sister is going to kill you. So Kamsa wanted to kill Devaki on the spot. But Vasudeva was a very good politician. He was not a Maharati. You know, some Kshatriyas were Maharatis, like Arjuna and Bhima, and even they were all very powerful fighters. Bhishma, Drona, all Maharatis. Vasudeva was not a Maharati. But he was a politician, he was a good talker. And Kamsa was going to kill Devaki, Vasudeva pleaded with him. And he told Kamsa, this will not be very good for you. If you kill your sister on the day of her marriage.
Sir, request your mobile, please silence when it is here.
On the day of her marriage, Vasudeva said, if you let people know that you killed your sister on the day of her marriage, then they will think you're very cruel, very bad for your reputation. But then Vasudeva also promised, you have no danger from anyone. There's no, but if in the future, if Devaki gives birth to children, I will deliver the children to you. He promised Kamsa like that. So Kamsa, he trusted the word of Vasudeva. He knew that he's a very honest person. So he agreed and he spared Devaki's life. And so Devaki and Vasudeva began their married life. But then different demon friends of Kamsa, they came to talk to Kamsa, to influence him, that don't be kind to them. You know, they're a great threat to you. They're going to give birth to a child who's going to kill you. So Kamsa put them in the prison. And when they gave birth to children, Kamsa killed the children. Actually, these children, they represent demonic elements. And Kamsa, by killing these children, he was removing all the inauspicious elements, the kam and the krodh and the lobh, the moha, mada, matsarya. He removed all these things from the world. And then the situation is auspicious. At that time, Lord Balaram came as the seventh child in the womb of Devaki. And he transferred later to the womb of Rohini. And then after Lord Balaram had come, then they're ready for Lord Krishna to come. Just like before the king comes, the ministers will come to make sure everything is very nice and organized. And so Balarama came to arrange everything properly for the appearance of Lord Krishna. Right, we're going to celebrate Janmashtami very soon.
26th August.
Okay. So before that, before the appearance of Lord Krishna is Balarama's appearance day. Balaram Purnima. On the full moon day, Lord Balaram comes. And so we have that first of all we celebrate Lord Balaram. Actually Lord Balaram is equal to Lord Krishna. The only difference is in the color. Lord Balaram is a white color and Lord Krishna is a dark bluish color. But they're equal in opulence, in strength, in fame, in every quality. Lord Balaram is also Bhagavan. They're two brothers. Lord Balaram is Dauji, the big brother. If you go to Vrindavan, there's a nice temple of Dauji. When we go for Parikrama there in Braja, we will go to visit the temple of Lord Balaram. And you can see also the wives of Lord Balaram. Lord Balaram had an interesting marriage. One of his wives was Revati. Revati was the daughter of Maharaj Revata. So it happened that Maharaj Revata knew he had a very nice daughter. So like any good father, they want to arrange a good husband for the daughter. So Maharaj Revata thought, I will take my daughter, we will go to see Lord Brahma. We'll go to Brahmalok. Lord Brahma resides at the top of the universe, Satyalok. You know, in the universe, we're on Bhumandala. The earth is in the middle of the universe. And above above us is Bhuvar, yeah? And then Swark, Swargaloka, heaven. The demigods are living there. Above Bhu and Bhuvar is Swark. And above the heavenly planets where the demigods reside, there are four more planets. Mahaloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka, and at the very top, Satyaloka, Lord Brahma. So this Maharaj Revata, he was a powerful king. It was Treta Yuga, it was not Dwapara Yuga, it was Treta Yuga. And he took his daughter all the way up to Satyaloka to see Lord Brahma. But when he got there, they said, oh, Lord Brahma's busy just now. He's attending a concert, a musical concert. You have to wait. And so the king waited with his daughter and waited. And after some time, Lord Brahma came. The concert finished and Lord Brahma came and the king introduced himself and told Lord Brahma the situation, that I want to know from you, I want you to advise me which king will be the right wife for my daughter, who will make the good husband for her. And so he mentioned the names of different kings. And when he mentioned the names of the different kings, Lord Brahma laughed. And he said, those kings all passed away long ago. And the king was surprised. He said, what? No, I was just there with them. They were all there. They were young men. And Lord Brahma said, yes, but that was before you came here. Now you've come up to Brahmaloka. You've been here, you've been waiting here. One moment of time is a year or more there on Earth planet. And so all those kings have already passed away long ago. Many generations ago have come and gone while you've been waiting here for me. So the king thought, oh, then what to do? What about my daughter? But Lord Brahma said, don't worry. He said, go back to Earth. The personality of Godhead, Lord Balaram, is there. He will make a good wife for your daughter. So the king came back and he found Lord Balarama and presented his daughter to Lord Balaram. But she was from the previous yuga, so she was very tall, you know. Every yuga we get smaller and smaller, you know. And so Lord Balaram, however, he took his plow, he's known as Haladara, the carrier of the plow. He took his plow and he pulled her down to make a nice height for him so that she could be a good wife for Lord Balarama. So Lord Balarama accepted her as his wife. Quite different from Lord Krishna's wives, you know. Lord Krishna, of course, had many wives. So Lord Krishna comes to give pleasure to his different devotees. He enjoys being with his wonderful devotees. Mother Yashoda, during the month of Kartik, we celebrate that wonderful pastime of Mother Yashoda chasing Lord Krishna and tying up baby Krishna. We enjoy offering the lamps and singing the Damodar Astikam for the pleasure of Lord Krishna during the month of Kartik. Lord Krishna enjoys that wonderful pastime with Mother Yashoda. Lord Krishna also enjoys being with the Pandavas and helping Arjuna in the battle of Kurukshetra and speaking Bhagavad Gita to Arjuna. And Lord Krishna has promised Arjuna, Kuntya priti janihi namid bhakta pranashati. My devotee will never perish. So Lord Krishna arranges for the welfare of his different devotees. He enjoys loving service. He's taking service from the devotees and he's giving service to the devotees. We don't have much to offer to Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, we can offer a leaf, a flower, a fruit, or water with love and devotion, then he will accept it. But he's not greedy to get our offerings. Some people may misunderstand. They may think, oh, he's a very greedy God. He wants so many things to be offered to him. But the things he's asking for are very simple. A leaf, a flower, fruit, water, they grow everywhere practically. You can find these things. And if we offer them to the Lord, then we greatly benefit. of course, it's not so much the offering which he wants, but he wants our love, the devotion with which we offer. That is the important quality. Lord Krishna is very attracted by devotion. And we learn from the Bhagavad Gita that we should cultivate that devotion. We should cultivate devotion through the mood of service. In the material world, everyone is competing with each other for master, to be the controller, to mastership. Especially if you work in the corporate world, it can be very stressing. People all competing for a higher position. One young lady I met, she was telling me how she worked very hard to get a job in the corporate world in Gurgaon, in Delhi there. And finally she got into a big company, but she said, oh, it was just the opposite of what I expected. She said it was so stressing and everybody was pushing each other. Everybody wanted to get a higher position than the other. There was no real mood of caring and cooperation. Rather, it was all pushing and shoving and one person wanting to get the better of another. So she felt very discouraged by the whole atmosphere of the corporate world. Material life is like that. People are competing with each other. We don't have a lot of care for each other. But Lord Krishna does care about his devotees. And the devotees, of course, they care a lot about Lord Krishna. Queen Kunti is a very special devotee of Lord Krishna. And she had offered a prayer in which she said, I wish that all the calamities will happen again and again. Right? She said, Vipada Shantuta Shasva Tatra Bhavato Dasnam Yachat Apunat Bhavat. Queen Kunti is praying to Krishna. She said, let all these calamities happen again and again. Usually, you know, we have a problem with it. Oh, I hope that won't happen again. You know, I wouldn't like to go through that again. You know, so much trouble. But Queen Kunti is just the opposite. She went through so many troubles, so many trials and tests of her own endurance, attempts on the life of her sons, and so many things happened to them. Their house was burnt down, they were put into the house of shellac, and they set the whole thing on fire. And oh, there were so many attempts on the life of the Pandavas, and then the chastity of Draupadi also was threatened, but Draupadi was protected. The Lord came in the form of the unlimited sari to save her chastity. So Queen Kunti is not regretful of all of these things, but she said, let all of these things happen again and again. Why? Death. A couple of weeks ago, we lost a very dear devotee to the yatra here. Chittahari Prabhu. Yeah, he rendered great service as a devotee. So Sri Balabha Prabhu, he asked me to speak about that famous statement by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, he reasons ill who tells that a Vaishnava dies when thou art living still and sound. A Vaishnava dies to live, and in living tries to spread the holy name around. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying, a Vaishnava dies to live. That the real life is not here so much in this world, because this world is a temporary place of birth and death. But we have eternal life waiting for us in the spiritual world, in the kingdom of God. The eternal life is there. We want that life. this life here is a training, it's a preparation for us to go there. We're preparing, we're practicing to go there. Just like we have the deity here. You can see the deities are put here and we practice worshipping. The Lord comes in the form of the deity and we practice serving Him. Here in this world, we're practicing serving the deity. And one day, we'll go to the spiritual world, we'll go to the kingdom of God, and we will serve Him there. So we are preparing ourselves for that, to transfer ourselves to His own abode, to engage in His eternal service. It is called Sanatana Dharma, the eternal religion of the soul. So Queen Kunti is offering beautiful prayers, encouraging us to remember Krishna, to practice remembering Lord Krishna. And she's given us some nice examples. Maybe you remember the Namo Pankaja
Namaya.
Namo Pankaja
Namaya.
Namo Pankaja
Namaya.
Namaste Pankaja. She's talking about how lotus flowers are a vision, help us to give a vision of Lord Krishna. That the Lord's navel is marked with the depression of the lotus flower. And His glance, the lotus eyes of Lord Krishna, His glance is as cooling as a lotus flower. And Lord Krishna was always decorated with a garland of lotus flowers, and Lord Krishna's lotus feet are marked with the impressions of lotus flowers. The lotus flower is one of the symbols of Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune. And Lakshmi, as we heard, we were reading Prabhupada's purport, she is the consort of Lord Narayan. Now Lakshmi is known as Chanchal. One of the names of Lakshmi is Chanchal. She's restless. We know ourselves, when we get Lakshmi, we cannot keep it for very long. It goes quickly, unfortunately, right? We cannot avoid these things. But Lakshmi, although she is Chanchal, she is very faithful to Lord Narayan. So when we worship Lord Narayan, Lakshmi is also there. She is the eternal consort of Lord Narayan. She never leaves Him. So it's important for us. We know some people, they make the mistake, they just worship Lakshmi and they forget about Lord Narayan. So you may worship Lakshmi and if you just worship her without Lord Narayan, you may get her blessing, but not for long, because she's Chanchala, she will go. But if you worship the Supreme Lord, Narayan, then she's very chaste and faithful to her husband. So we want to understand these spiritual truths. It's important for us to cultivate our devotion for Lord Krishna. It is devotion which is the qualification to take up spiritual life. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna describes Yesham Twantakatam Papam Jananam Punya Karmana Tidanvam Mohanirmukta Vajantimam Dridavrata. Dridavrata means determination, a vow of determination. We want to take up devotional service like that with great determination. We don't want to just take it up whimsically, to begin it and then give it up after some time. We want to properly, faithfully engage in devotional service continually. So Lord Krishna describes, he said, we have to cultivate certain qualifications to qualify for that devotional service. and he mentions the qualifications. He said, people who have acted piously in previous lives and in this life and who are free from the reactions of sinful activities and who are no longer subject to delusion, then they engage themselves in my service with determination. So Lord Krishna mentions about the importance of getting free from sinful reactions. It's, as devotees, we all try very strictly to avoid sinful activities. Sinful activities means eating things which are like animal flesh, then you will get some karma, you will get some sinful reactions for that. One devotee, what the Mataji was telling me, that she was in the supermarket and she, one young man was there and he saw she was wearing kunti mala. So he asked, oh, you're a devotee? And she said, yes. And he said, you know, I also wanted, he said, I also wanted to wear the kunti mala. But he said, I'm working in supermarket and my job is in the butcher, in the meat section of the supermarket. So he said, I was supposed to get the kunti mala from another devotee, but when he heard that I'm working in the meat, he wouldn't give me. He said, no, you cannot wear, you're working in that place. He said, you have to change the job. So he said, is it like that? So I said, actually, yes, it's like that. Because you work with the meat, you're selling the meat, you will get some karma for that, you'll get reactions. Even though you don't cook the meat, you don't eat the meat, if you sell it, and then you're working in the supermarket, selling the meat, and preparing it, packing it, putting it on, then you get karma for these things. You're involved. So we like to stay away from these things because sinful reactions will cause problems in our material life. We already have problems in our material life and we will create more problems by these different situations. So we have to be very careful. We want to avoid the sinful activities. So, Lord Krishna said we should perform pious activity. How to get this pious activities? And one devotee, he read this verse and he was thinking, he came to Prabhupada and he said, Srila Prabhupada, did I become a devotee because of my pious activities? And Prabhupada just laughed at him. He said, no, he said, it's not that you did anything pious. He said, but because you're a devotee and because you're trying to practice Krishna consciousness, that is your piety. That is how you get pious activity. By serving Prabhupada and Prabhupada's mission, it creates piety and it gives us a qualification to take up devotional service. It is, and by serving the great souls, the Mahatmas, it opens the doors to liberation. So coming to Krishna consciousness like that, chanting Hare Krishna, and even we may not chant, if we simply hear, we get a lot of benefit. Just like in Damodar Puja, Damodar Astika, we tell people about that wonderful pastime about the one man. He came to a holy place during Kartik time. And this man, he never did any pious activity, but somehow he'd come to this holy place during the month of Kartik. And he was surprised when he saw people, some were chanting prayers, and some were worshipping the deity, and some were chanting mantras, some were going on parikrama around the different holy places. He'd never seen all these things before. He himself, he used to sell animal skins, bones and skulls, he was not pious at all. But somehow he'd come to this holy place during Kartik. And he saw people doing all these different things. And then it came to the end of the Kartik time. And just on the last day of the Kartik in the evening, a big poison snake appeared and it bit this man. And the man was bit by the snake, he fell down. And people rushed, they all came to help him, they sprinkled water, they tried to revive him, but they couldn't save him. And he died. And what happened? His soul was taken by the Yamaduts and they took him to Yamaraj. They brought this man to Yamaraj, and Yamaraj, of course, he's got his secretary there, Chitragupta. And Chitragupta checked on the records. Has this man done, what has he done? And Chitragupta said, this man, he said, he never did anything pious, all sinful activities. So Lord Yamaraj said, take him to Kumbhipakaloka. You know Kumbhipakaloka?
Yes.
You know that place? Huh? There's a big wok, boiling oil. Fry him in the wok, in the boiling oil. So the Yamaduras, they took him and they took him down to Kumbhipakaloka and they threw him in the boiling oil. And as soon as they put him in the oil, immediately the oil became cool. It all became cool. And the Yamaduras were shocked. They'd never seen anything like this before. And they, quick, go and get Lord Yamaraj. Lord Yamaraj came. That time Narada Muni also came. And Narada Muni told them, he said, you won't be able to harm this man. They said, but he's very sinful. He never did anything pious. They said, no, during the Damodar month, he was there. He never did anything, but he watched people do all the worship. He watched it and he heard everything. He got 1/6 of the benefit of all their pious activities. So all of his sinful reactions were all destroyed. So they said, you cannot harm him. So this is the power. Bhakti yoga, devotional self. If people just see, they don't have to take part. They just see and hear, they get so much benefit. Their sinful reactions are all destroyed and they develop piety. So it's very important for us to engage in these different activities, not only for our own benefit, but to benefit others as well. I mean, we're devotees, we're meant to be caring and compassionate for others. And we think how to deliver others. It's important for us. Yeah?
I have a question. So when you practice Bhakti Yoga,
Well, karma is a very complex thing. You have to understand which body is going to get punished. You're going to get punished one way or the other. Whether it's the past body or the new body, some karma will take reaction, the reactions will come immediately. And other times the karma will be delayed. You know, there's different stages of the fructification of the seeds of sinful reactions. some seeds, some karmic reactions, they're visible in the body, not, and others are not visible, they're waiting to become visible. It's going to take more time. You just have to be patient and wait and see. So you don't know.
It gets fructified, right, when the time comes, because it's, these are your prarabdhas and all this. So it depends on what body you take and those karmas get attached to it. But like when something is already decided, you are traveling to the Narakloka where you have to get the punishment. But then what which body is that? Because material body you have already given in the Mrityuloka, now you are traveling. And with the Pindadan that we do for the 12 days, you get a new body. So, because see, it's the soul that travels. But then during the travel time, in a journey, you get new body, which is during
yeah, the but the subtle body goes with you, right? You get a gross body, but the subtle body is coming with you. With the soul, along with the soul, the subtle body is coming. The subtle body is carrying the desires. It's carrying the seeds of your sinful reactions with the subtle body.
So that's get punished.
Yes. It's a subtle body which is carrying. So this is there for everyone in the material world. That's why it's very important for us to practice controlling the mind, to bring the mind, to fix the mind on the lotus feet of the Lord. When we're chanting, we have to hear. We want to hear the holy name. We want to remember. We don't want to just do things mechanically, but we want the mind should also be applied in the service of Krishna. Right? When you're cooking for Krishna, when you're making garlands, making a garland for Krishna. We're cleaning Krishna's temple. We want to control the mind. Maharaj Ambarish was the great devotee, so he was engaging in so many activities of devotion. But the very first thing he did was Savai Mana Krishna. Yeah, he fixed his mind on the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. And similarly, Arjuna, he was to fight the battle, but Lord Krishna told him, first of all, fix your mind on me, and then perform your duty. It's not, well, I have to do my duty. But before you do your duty, the very first duty is to bring the mind to Krishna, to fix the mind on the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. That's very important. So we are practicing this process of devotion. We are practicing bringing the mind to think of Krishna. How to do it? Every moment we have to battle with the mind. The mind is chanchal, it's also chanchal, it's also restless. But we have to train it. We have to make it faithful and chaste. Bring wherever the mind wanders due to its restless and unsteady state, bring it back. Bring it back to the lotus feet of Lord Krishna. That is important for us. Practicing, remembering Krishna. So it comes about, by nature we have love of Krishna. It's in our heart. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita it said, Nitya Siddha Krishna Prem Shaja Kabunai Shravanadi Shuta Chitti Korehi Udai. Love of Krishna, Krishna prema is in everyone's heart, but we have to awaken it by hearing about Krishna. Hearing, we have to hear. And of course, sometimes we have no taste to hear, we don't have the interest, but we can develop the taste by service. If we do service for Krishna, practicing service, doing service, then gradually we get an interest, we want to hear more and more. Again, it's practicing. Arjuna said, I cannot control my mind. It's very difficult. But Lord Krishna said, Asamshayam Mahabaho Manu Durnigraham Chalam Abhyasena Chukontiya Vairagena. Lord Krishna said, it is undoubtedly difficult work to control the mind, but it is possible. Two things are required: practice, abhyas, and vairag, detachment. We have to practice and we have to develop some detachment. If we're holding on, then how are you going to get detached? You're trying to hold on. We have to let go. Just like Draupadi, when they were trying to rip off her sari, she was trying to fight them back. But then she just surrendered to Krishna. She put her hands up in the air and she called out Govinda. And Krishna came as her sari and protected her. So we have to practice taking shelter of Krishna. And we have to practice regularly, more. If we keep practicing, it will become natural. Just like you learn to drive a car, you practice. You learn to play the piano, you practice. You learn to use a computer by practice. You have to practice bringing the mind to remember Krishna. We can do it. We want to put Radha and Krishna in our hearts, right? Seat them in the heart. And the heart should be nice and clean. We should make the heart nice and clean for Krishna to sit there in the heart. And how to clean the heart? How do you clean the heart?
Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Very good. Okay, Hare Krishna. Any other question?
Maharaj, one more question.
Yes.
Like you said, in the other universe, Brahmaji is like the bigger one. What we have is a four face. So when, because of the karmas and all this, do we also, you know, go to those universes, or we go to only this 14 loka, which is a combination, or this combination also exists in the other universes?
Oh yes, it's similar in other universes also, 14 different levels within each universe. You've got the heavenly planets in the upper region of the universe, and the more demoniac planets in the lower region of the universe. And at the bottom of the universe you've got the hellish planets.
The Sutal, Atal, Vittal and all this. So this is a combination of 14 lokas. Similarly, in the other universe also we have the same combination?
Yes.
And then, do we pass from this, like if we finish this journey, whatever the 84, you know, thousand, you know, the births that we have to take, by any chance we also pass on one of the birth or any other journey to the other universe also, or we only remain within the same universe and these 14 lokas?
Well, from this one place, we can go directly back to Godhead. You don't have to go to all the other places. But if you are attracted to go to the other place, you know, if you have that desire, then Krishna, of course, will take you there to these other places. But if your only desire is to go to be with Krishna, then you go directly to the spiritual world. You don't need to see these other places. You don't need to go to the heavenly planets. If you read the book, there's one book, Brihad Bhagavat Amrita. So it tells about one young man from Govardhan. He was a cowherd boy. His name was Gop Kumar. And he got a mantra from his guru. And by the power of his mantra, he went to all the different places in the universe. And he went to the heavenly planets. He saw the demigods are arguing with each other, quarreling there. He saw things were not very pleasant there in the heavenly planets. And so he... Thank you. So he saw there were problems in the heavenly planets. And he went to higher planets, different places in the universe, and he saw also there was everywhere there was something which he didn't like, which didn't feel so nice. And he went beyond. So he'll tell you about the nature of these different places. Although they may be very opulent, but still there's problems. There's some things there which are not quite right, which don't make it so attractive, so pleasing. So Gop Kumar went on and he went on and he went on, he went on higher, he went out of the universe, he went into the spiritual world, he went to the Brahmajyoti, he went beyond the Brahmajyoti, he came into Vaikuntha. But even in Vaikuntha he wanted to go to Goloka, where he could have direct reciprocation with the Lord. So the supreme planet is Goloka Vrindavan. But, of course, if you want to waste a lot of time, you can go to all the other places.
Suppose they say, if you are not able to complete Bhakti properly, then we go to Swarg and then come back again.
Yeah.
To heaven.
Right.
So, yeah. Over there, will we get that memory, or will we remember Krishna and Swarg, so we can go from there, or any chance we can get the birth fast and we can do bhakti, continue bhakti.
Yes, we have to want pure love for Krishna, then you can go to be with Krishna. But if we have some kind of material desire, then we'll take birth in the material planets, you know. We'll be in the heavenly planets or something. Be there.
Will we be able to remember Krishna over there?
Well, yes, you may remember Krishna, but for what purpose? Are you remembering Krishna to get something from Krishna? Do you want something from Krishna, is it? You want Krishna to
continue bhakti.
To continue bhakti.
We didn't do bhakti properly in this Janma, so we end up in being heavenly planets. By Krishna's mercy or anything, we can remember Krishna and then...
We end up in the heavenly planets. Usually what happens in the heavenly planet, they'll come back here because it's easier to do bhakti here. In the heavenly planets, it's more difficult to do bhakti because there's so much opulence and sense gratification. It makes it difficult to remember Krishna. So this is the best place to do bhakti. So they go to the heavenly planets, you enjoy your sense gratification, and then come back here. And then you...
Not necessary if we go to heavenly planets, what if we go to Narak also? So are we able to remember Krishna?
Well, if you remember Krishna in Narak, it's not very easy, because so hell is, there's so much suffering there, but if you can remember him there, then that is a great success. Srila Prabhupada said, England was like hell. He said, this England is hell. It's every day cloudy, rainy, cold, you know. So practicing remembering Krishna is easiest here on this planet. But lower planets, very hard. So much so. Heavenly planets also difficult. Distraction. But here, possible. Okay, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.